Good morning, everyone. I'm Christy Listelle, the Community Engagement Officer from the Gold Coast Waterways Authority. Thanks very much for coming down this morning. We're a little worried about numbers 5 minutes ago, but it's definitely filled out now, so thank you. We're extremely excited to be a partner of Marinas 19 this year and have the chance to share our insights with you all. A bit of housekeeping to begin. The toilets are just up those stairs to the right. You'll find the emergency exits to the side of the room, one at the back, and please put your phones on silent. Hopefully most of you know, but for those who don't, the Gold Coast Waterways Authority focuses on three key areas: to sustain, enhance, and promote. Sustaining our waterways, so enabling people to enjoy the waterways safely and responsibly. Enhancing our waterways with our infrastructure program and building resilience to protect their environmental values, and promoting our beautiful waterways, so encouraging residents, visitors, and businesses to make the most of them. Today you'll be hearing from three of our team members on a variety of topics, from our first class capabilities for responding to vessel oil pollution, how we're providing better access to our waterways, and how we're planning for population growth. First up, we'll have Glen Jackson. Glen is one of the longest serving members on the National Response Team for oil spills. His work has taken him to dozens of locations, from New Zealand to the Great Barrier Reef, and most recently, the Solomon Islands. He leads GCWA's Waterways Operations Team, who manage and maintain more than $12 million worth of infrastructure. Not a small job. Glen was recently flown to the Solomon Islands to help clean up a remote oil spill after spending 14 days on a 1960s tugboat in very close quarters. He'll tell you exactly what it's like to be on one of those teams responding to such a disaster. He'll also show you the best equipment to have on hand at your marina and what steps you should take if you encounter an oil spill. At GCWA, we have a waterways team who look after a variety of areas, from permits for aquatic events to anchoring and maintaining our navigational aids. Glen manages the on-water operations team, who look after the areas listed on the screen here. Glen, can you talk us through what a typical day looks like in your team? And as you would all know, the waterways are a very complex environment with a number of different organisations and agencies looking after each issue. So we created this handy spreadsheet to outline the roles and responsibilities of each government department. So whatever inquiry you have, you'll find it on the left-hand side, and you simply go across and it'll tell you the correct department to speak with. And then on the back, it has all the contact details. So we created this and uploaded it on our website, but we've also brought copies today if you'd like one. They're just out on the tables here. Super handy sheet to laminate and have on hand and have, you know, that at your fingertips and know who to contact. And as mentioned earlier, Glen here is one of the longest serving members on the National Response Team and he attends regular training. Glen, can you speak us through a bit more about your training?
Right.
And GCWA looks after the first strike response for the Gold Coast area. Now that area is from the New South Wales border right through to the southern end of Russell Island and Logan River. Glen, can you tell us the most common spills you see out there?
Stormwater drains, same thing, rain periods, because rain for a while, comes out the drains from the vessels. Coral spawn's a big one.
Perfect. Thank you very much for that, Glen. When we hear in the office that Glen's been flown to the Solomon Islands to help with an oil spill, there's a bit of jealousy going around. But when we see the photos, it's a very different reality, and I don't think I'd want to be there. Now we'll open it up to any questions you may have. If you just want to raise your hand if you've got a question, and Jessica will grab the roaming mic and come around. I'll start us off. I want to know the basics. What do you eat when you're on the ship for 14 days in close quarters?
So Solomon Islands, being like a third world country, it's not like re-tendering Timor Sea in Darwin. You're eating, you put on weight in Darwin. Over in the Solomons, it's sort of like small meals, rice, typical food, chicken, and a few salads, vegetables. Myself, get a bit of wine cheese, wine, so.
Anyone else have any? Yeah, one up the back here.
I just had a question regarding dispersants.
Yeah.
Obviously, you know, your sunlight soap and all that sort of stuff's a no-no, but I know there is a ANZA-approved dispersant. What is the difference between that just your normal sort of degreaser or whatever that you would use in that situation?
I can't get too much into dispersants. It's not my side of things, but it's an approved list, so. For dispersants, it's got to be on the approved list that ANZA has, so you can't just run out. So when you go to school, everyone brings one that you've got. This one will work, so we can't try. It's got to go through the ANZA, they run the lead test. They got all the past scientists all get up for that side of things. They'll tell you how much you can put per parts of a million into the water. So different applications, so you'll see it in the photos. It's like mist coming from the back of the boat. Small stuff, so as bad as it is, it does happen, and most of the time it's only a small overflow. As soon as it hits the water, you'll see it spreads really quick. So your unleaded fuel burns off really quick. Let it go, don't contain it in the area. So if you boom it, it then becomes a bit of a volatile area, being such a, it ignites easy. So whether it's diesel, you can boom it and contain it. So on your fuel wharf, if you have some sort of spill kit there ready, just a couple of absorbent booms, you just throw it around. Most of your pontoons, there's only a small area where it can go through, so if you run a boom across it, and basically like a majority of it is just oil, probably 95% of it, like your fuels and very little water. So yeah, we'll know straight away. Give us a dollar, but again, depending on where it is and who's close, it's just a matter of reporting it. You just tell us on the phone, and you know, we can go from there, work out what your best approach is.
Any other questions?
Yep. Glen, I know you've been to some of the best suppliers as well. Is it a different situation, or how different is it?
Yeah.
Fire versus a spill?
So with vessel fires, usually you turn up, vessel's on fire, fireys will get there, they're first thing you put the fire out. So whether they put it out, vessel sinks, and then you'll have everything come out. Or even if the vessel doesn't sink, then you'll have all their foam and all the burnt stuff coming from the vessel. So you still do the same thing, put your burns out. It does restrict all the stuff coming from it, as in you burn bits of timber, fiberglass and that. But when the vessel does sink, obviously your fuel tanks, some of your big boat fires, like the Versace boat fires, back in about 2011, three boats put on fire, a couple of them had, you know, a couple of thousand litres of fuel on board, so you've got to try and eliminate it. There was divers that come along from the insurance company, walked everything straight up, so source once again, because obviously, you know, you talk thousands, 2,000 litres of fuel, it would probably come with your orders. Yeah, eliminate sources, you pick one straight up, and then you start off with your response from there.
Anyone else have some? Yeah.
Yeah, you mentioned about the foam.
Yes.
Used for putting the fire out. The foam is a pollutant itself, or?
Another question down the front here. Any other questions at this stage? Yeah, up the back there.
The maritime incidents tend to be reasonably expensive. What's the extent of cost recovery to the authority of the insurers or the owner of the vessel, the uninsured?
So vessels over 15 metres in Queensland have a standard insurance for large vessels because of that size of things where it is expensive. So all this stuff costs lots. When you do the bigger responses, everything, you know, at first, it's straight away at it, but you still got to be mindful of your costs, so you can't just, if it's a small school, you can't just have all these resources coming. So, you know, you've got to be cautious how way. The Versace boat follows, you know, there was three vessels, two of them had the same insurance company, another one was a different one. Same thing, I couldn't just have all these people there every day, you sort of start scaling down once you've got your first strike, you control it. So, like some of the bigger ones, when I went to Arena, like the first day we turned up there, there was something, first day it was like $1.8 million into it. So the very big, all the big ships have their thing on it. So.
Anyone else got any burning questions? Yeah. Is that it, everyone? It seems like we're all up there. So thank you very much for that, Glen. We now have... We've got about 15 minutes spare now until John Bendel speaks next about how creating better access to our waterways. So feel free to wander, chat amongst yourselves, and Glen will still be here in the room if you want to come up and have a question one-on-one. So we'll kick off at 9:45 just in case anyone else was coming from one of the other talks. Thank you.